But between 1992 and 1995, Bosnia was at war, and this country was synonymous with death, with displacement, with destruction. You can see the building of an army burnt out and shelled. But if you come over here, you'll see a different side to this country. This is the capital, incredible views, and an amazing city down there. Welcome to Sarajevo. Since the turn of the century, I've been to 140 countries and I've watched football across six continents. In April 2016, I watched four incredible derbies on consecutive weekends, and one of those games stood out among the rest. It was a match in the heart of the Balkans, in the Bosnian capital of Sarajevo, between Zvezdanice and FK Sarajevo. So before the war, Bosnia was part of one of the most ethnically and religiously diverse countries of anywhere in Europe. You had Bosnians who were predominantly Muslim, Serbs who were principally Orthodox Christian, and Croats who were mostly Catholic, sharing space, living side by side in the Bosnian and Herzegovina capital of Sarajevo. So I travelled to Bosnia to meet some Sarajevans, to explore what life is like in the Bosnian capital. This film documents an overland journey from Croatia to Bosnia. It examines the nature and legacy of conflict and the siege of Sarajevo. And it explores the meaning of football in the city on Derby Day. For a European capital, Sarajevo is not a particularly easy city to access. Budget airlines haven't yet embraced Bosnia, no doubt a legacy of conflict in the country. So I flew to northeastern Croatia and travelled overland from Osijek to the Serbian border and then to Bosnia, heading south to Sarajevo, passing through some significant sites from the Yugoslav wars. So here we are on the border between Serbia and Croatia, just on the Croatian side. And you can see on the buildings around me, evidence of warfare, the legacy of the conflict between 92 and 95 in what was known as Yugoslavia. So we're currently on a bridge over the Danube in no man's land between Croatia and Serbia. We weren't allowed to pass with the car into Serbia from Croatia because we didn't have a green card. So we are walking the 2 kilometres across no man's land. So we've just crossed the border into Serbia. When we got to the border, the border guard said to us, whatever you do, you can't film here, no photos. Probably quite relieved that there was no cameras, no CCTV on the bridge. But we are in Serbia. And they even give the old passport a stamp. So this is Serbia. So as you can see behind me, evidence of conflict. During the 1990s, Vukovar, this border town on the Croat-Serbian border, was one of the epicentres of violence, and one of the disagreements in the breakup of the Yugoslavia was about where the borders should be drawn up of these newly independent states. And the Serbs were adamant that the borders should be drawn up on ethnic lines, and there were a lot of ethnic Serbians living in Vukovar. And the Croats were adamant that the divisions should have been similar to those that were in effect during the Yugoslav era. So this place became a symbol of the conflict. And it's 2016, and look at the evidence still in place of the conflict.
Most of these Croatian border towns bear the scars of conflict, whether it's Vukovar or Nustar or Vinkovci. And street art in these places often represents symbols of national identities, usually interwoven with religion. Remembering victims and the sacrifice of martyrs, the brutality of conflict. And football graffiti usually sits in the midst of these war memorials, evidence of what matters to the people, and that civic loyalties are layered over national rivalries.
So here in Arasje, in Bosnia, we have the call to prayers coming from the minaret of the mosque. In front we have a monument to Catholics whose lives were lost during the war. The people here seem at peace with the multi-faiths and multi-ethnicities and identities that seem to be sharing space and sharing territory. This is Bosnia in 2016.
As a reflection of its history, its conflicts and its diversity, modern-day Bosnia-Herzegovina is a complicated state, with a three-member presidency representing the three ethnic groups of Bosniaks, Serbs and Croats. The country is also split into two largely autonomous entities, the Federation of Bosnia-Herzegovina and the Republic of Srpska. Although these territories are clearly signposted, you can currently cross these borders freely without having documents checked. In addition, the Brčko district is a separate neutral unit.
So we are on the outskirts of Brčko in the Republic of Srpska, on the top of the stand of a half-built football ground, which is the most dangerous ground I think I've ever seen. It just drops off from this top tier. So here we are in rural Bosnia, waiting for our dinner. This is on a spit, and when that's been finished, there's a second one here. Look at this little fella. So we're driving south through Bosnia, and the map we've got isn't brilliant, so I was looking out for a map on the side of the road, and then we passed this one and thought it might be of use, but it's a map to landmines that are still buried in the land behind us from the Bosnian War.
Croats, Serbs and Bosniaks who live here speak mutually intelligible languages, yet separate spoken and written versions began to emerge after the breakup of Yugoslavia. Modern road signs include place names in both Cyrillic and Latin alphabets. Defacing the language of a neighbour can be viewed as symbolic, a reminder of who is welcome and who isn't. It's politics in paint. The final stop before Sarajevo is the city of Tuzla, which was the site of a massacre during the Bosnian War. The conflict wasn't fought on clearly defined battlegrounds, but in villages, towns and cities. This massacre claimed victims as young as 3 years old.
So we are at the stadium of FK Slobodan, one of the Bosnian sides in the city of Tuzla. But we're really here for the derby in Sarajevo. Tomorrow, the two biggest clubs in the Bosnian League come together for one of the best derbies on the Balkans and anywhere in Europe. And I can't wait.
From whichever direction you travel, any overland journey to Sarajevo, particularly one that crosses borders from neighbouring countries, is one you're never likely to forget.
Heading up to the Olympic Park in Sarajevo, and you just come across buildings like this, shelled,
burnt out. Such destruction. And then on the other hand, you see views like that. Welcome to Sarajevo.
So in 1984, there was an Olympic Games in Yugoslavia and it was held here in Sarajevo. And this is what's left of the bobsleigh track. So I'm with Skander, who's a Bosnian, and we are in Sarajevo, and Skander's taking you through some of the history of what happened in the city and in the wider kind of political context through the war.
You hear terms like genocide and and massacre. What's the difference between those two for you?
Yeah, today it's just game of words, in my opinion. The thing is the same. People are being killed. The idea of this ethnical cleansing was to completely ethnically clean one part of one group, to move them out of these areas, and that is something what is referred to as a genocide, while the massacre is something believed to be on a smaller scale.
So I've been to various parts of what was Yugoslavia, and when you're in Serbia or in Croatia or in Bosnia, they have kind of different versions of the same kind of stories. Sometimes they use phrases like liberation, sometimes it was more about ethnic cleansing. Yes. So what do you think was the, in essence, the cause of the conflict here?
The cause of the conflict today is one of the most important questions that today us who even live in this country, Bosnia, can hardly even understand why the war break out. Today the idea was a Serbian pretension over the idea of greater Yugoslavia, Serbian leadership. Milosevic and faces like his followers, his ideologists, when the Bosnia wanted to break away from Yugoslavia, they basically thought the only way to stop independence of this country, to stop the Bosnian separation from Yugoslavia, was a military way. And in their perception, it was like that. In our perception, it was to defend our country, to defend our lives. So in the end, what happens today is you have two different stories. For Serbs, they would say that they wanted to protect Yugoslavia, they wanted basically to keep Yugoslavia as one. For us, we would say we did not want to live in this greater Serbia, which was a Serbian-dominated country. If you travel in different parts of Yugoslavia, you can pretty much hear different interpretations of the same thing. This is a tunnel, this is the airport behind us. So we are standing now on this side of the airport itself. So you can see behind the mountain is what we used to refer to the pre-Bosnian territory. So that is one part of the Bosnia which we controlled, and this is the rest of the city. So when the war broke out, the major focus that all the Serbs had was to surround the city, including the airport itself. They did that very easily in the beginning days of the airport. So they thought if they connect with this, they close Sarajevo like this, they split up the city like that, connecting with the soldiers in the barracks over here, taking over both different sides of the city one by one. If they managed to split up Sarajevo, this part of the city, which was the most inhabited part, wouldn't make it in time of the war because you would have no access to the UN, from the UN supplies, no tunnel supplies getting to the city. So that's why I said the greatest battle of defense of Sarajevo in the time of the war was actually on the river over here. So once they couldn't get into the city, from that moment there would be bombing, and then from May 1992 there were severe bombings on Sarajevo. Per day on average you would have some 330 bombs. The largest number of bombs which was hitting the city in time of the war was like 3,700 bombs. In July 1993, because they were constantly trying to take over some parts around the city, and we were constantly trying to defend ourselves, and they couldn't make it. All this road, actually, we would call it Sniper Alley, because from any of these positions, you could be seen and targeted. But the most dangerous part of the Sniper Alley is around here. So anybody in time of the war who was trying to move from the old town city center to these lower parts of the city, when you're on the crossroads, like this one here, this one here, sniper can reach you. So many people in Sarajevo have been killed by snipers, and that is why we call this a Sniper Alley.
So the famous Sniper Alley in Sarajevo, on the right side, the yellow building is Hotel Holiday Inn. That was the only officially working hotel in Sarajevo during the war. All the journalists would come to Sarajevo would be staying in that hotel pretty much, and it was like under protection of the UN and would be spared of destruction, most of it. But the moment you're outside here, nobody can guarantee you. So sniper fire, any of these crossroads you were trying to cross, you could easily die, just like that. the right side here, very soon you cannot see a green market, and on the far right end of the market you can see there is a glass made wall on the right further there in the red color. That's the list of names of people who are killed on this market. 67 people died here by the bomb explosion. And this yellow building on the left is another market inside, like meat market. I see this red stain on the ground here and this kind of white panel. This is a reminder that the bomb exploded there. It's called Sarajevo Rose, and in front of this building a mortar came and killed 43 people waiting in line for food at the time.
In June 1992, United Nations took over this airport. And once UN took over the airport, it enabled us somehow to connect, I told you, this free Bosnian territory with the rest of the city. This is like a 2 kilometer run, but the most dangerous part is this runway across which you have to run, some like 450 meters, and the Serbian sniper shooting at you. So people run from the city to get to this side, to the free Bosnian territory in the village of Hrasnica or on mountain of Igman, get the food, and then wait for proper time and run back. And I told you some 800 people roughly are killed on the runway itself until we dig a tunnel.
So this is the path of the tunnel, 800 meters under the
airport.
Under
the airport, yes.
End of March of 93, 1 year after the war break out, we were defending ourselves in the city for 1 year without a single amount of weapons coming from the outside into the city. We used to homemade weapons on the barracks, local people, if they had some things, police, if they had some things, would be contributing to the city. This used to be pipes for oil, to pump the oil, because we used to pump the oil into the city, the cables for electricity, the railroad for the carriages on rails, on wheels, because it would be much faster and easier way to transfer things. There were telephone lines as well.
In some parts it's even lower than 160.
So walking through the tunnel, built in Sarajevo under the airport to smuggle food and weapons.
Well, this is the chair that the president sits on when he travelled through the tunnel.
So once you dig the tunnel, we start getting stuff in, and until the end of the war there was no way for them to take over the city anymore in the way they were maybe hoping, because we had something to resist and to defend ourselves. But the biggest advantage we had was that we were dedicated, so we actually would not give it up. We knew if they break through, we all dead. For the Serbian, the stake wasn't that big. There were soldiers around, their families were pretty, those who were from the city, their families were outside on a safe basis. Those who came as the paramilitaries would not risk as much. So that is why actually, even though much less armed, but with much more dedication, we managed to survive in that time of war. Because my father knew if he fails, then his kids are dead. That's how the thing pretty much would work in our perception. When we fight with them, around Sarajevo only soldiers. And those are our targets, Bosnian army targets. But when they bomb the city, they're killing civilians. So 90-something percent of population who was killed in Sarajevo are civilians. People every day waiting in line for bread, in line for water, in line for food. They are, I mean, kids, small kids, they are the targets. And that is why in Sarajevo we estimate that 11,541 people were killed. At the time, anybody who wants to fight would more or less had the opportunity to do it. Some people, on the other hand, would try to avoid that.
Yeah.
You know, not everyone are like patriots, not everyone are for war, and not everyone are courageable enough to fight a war. So it was like problem. I know that sometimes you have people who don't want to fight, who are escaping, etc., or deserting.
How did the people discover information about the developments of the war? What did they rely on?
Yeah, it was very hard. I mean, I remember when I was a child, my mother, constant thing she would be doing was listening to radio. Because all telephones were dead, there was no electricity in time of the war, so we could not watch television. But we were also getting different stations, ones which were broadcast out of propaganda. And you were only hoping that what you hear comes from Bosnian media was true, and what you hear was coming from Serbian media was fake. And when my father would leave into some areas of front lines around Bosnia, we could not know if he was alive or not. We had no contact with him. We could only hope he was okay. Only when he came back home, we could know he was okay. Or that was like a few weeks, usually month period.
It must have been incredible waiting for your dad to come home.
Sure. So you look. I remember. I look in the window, and every day I hope he's coming. But we roughly knew the period was like 1 month. what will be his absence from home. The idea of multiculturalism survived in the city because some, I told you, some of the greatest heroes of defense of this city in time ago are the Serbs, who, people who basically live in the city, who don't differentiate the neighbors based on this religious background, meanings of the names, etc. But unfortunately, some rural parts of our country, you have some of the most important war perpetrators. Unfortunately, in Bosnia, you have so many cases in which the people you used to know, the people you used to spend lives together, at the end of the day, happen to be some of your worst enemies for some reason.
For some of the Serbs living in Sarajevo, were they used by the Serbs for their inside knowledge of where the Bosniaks were living?
Sure. Of course, some of the local residents of Sarajevo are becoming the tippers. They tip off.
Yeah.
They say, okay, this house here belongs to that person, this house belongs to that person. It's a very common thing.
So did that create a culture of distrust among the different ethnic groups?
Of course. I mean, in the time of the war, unfortunately, the days came in the sense that nobody trusted anybody. Unfortunately, they meant that they have succeeded to divide people. They have succeeded, and even today, the politicians of this region are succeeding to divide people as much as possible, to divide them on this basis, who is a Catholic or Catholic, a Croat, who is Orthodox, who is Serbian, who is a Bosnian, who is a Muslim, etc. So they have created this idea of untrust, and unfortunately today, after even 20-something years of war, people have not managed to break these barriers. In some sense, that still lives on. The real process of reconciliation, unfortunately, still is not happening. It happens between normal people, no problem, you know, between normal, but somewhere higher up above us, some levels which we cannot control, some levels of political establishment of this country, they have interest of this region, they have interest to be people divided, for people to be divided, and as long as they are divided, they are able to rule them. The moment the people come together, that's the worst time for them.
Divide and conquer.
Yes, that's very common. So that is what happened in the time of the war. Even maybe there were people who would not want to take participation, I mean, not maybe, definitely, people would not want to take participation in war, but they were in some sense forced to choose sides.
Can you tell someone is a Bosniak or a Serb or a Croat by looking at them? Or
no, you cannot. After you know the name, you can pretty much guess from which, what is the origin of that person's background. In some ways, if the people are from different regions, then you can say by accent. In Sarajevo, no. It's one language, pretty much, it's hard to say. I mean, if you talk to somebody, you don't know his name, you cannot say. But in Bosnia, in some way, you can more or less understand from which region person comes from, and then by knowing from which region he comes from his accent, you can guess what would be his background. But you cannot know it until you know him personally.
When we were traveling through across the region to Sarajevo, on that journey, there was lots of places where we saw signs from mines, landmines.
Okay.
Lots of the areas around in rural parts of Bosnia, are they still very heavily landmines?
Today, some official report we say that there's only like 2.4% of the country which is mines. Mines used to be and are only in the parts of the country which used to be the front lines.
Right.
So for example, here right now where we are standing, in time of the war was the front line. Bosnian army was down there, soldiers were here, so this narrow sector between us and these houses was potentially dangerous for mines. There's huge prejudice over the country with full of mines, etc. It's not that serious.
So maybe some of the mines are just in the mind?
It's in the mind, and of course, we know where not to go. When you see the marked area, don't go that way.
Is it still in the process of finding people better?
Yes, this is a constant process. This is a constant process trying to exhume the mass graves, trying to find the tips. Just 2 years ago, the biggest mass grave in Bosnia was discovered in northeastern Bosnia, called Tomasica, in which some roughly 1,100 to 1,200 bodies have been found.
And Srebrenica as well.
And Srebrenica is an ongoing story. In Srebrenica, you have 6,000 people been buried, remaining 2,000 people out of 8,300 are still missing. So it's still an ongoing process.
How did the people come to live together peacefully again at the end of the war?
In the end of the war, I would say people, what prevented this country from going into another problem was huge. First of all, there was a huge amount of international forces presence to make sure that just after the war things go smooth.
We've just seen the UN trucks, that's
evidence
of that.
Some reminders of that time. But also I would say Bosnian people were hoping that justice will prevail in the end of the day. The people who did crimes will be prosecuted, and they will end up in international court of war crimes in Hague or in Bosnian court of war crimes over here. So people somehow believed in justice. So at the end of the war, I would say that people did not feel any need to take the justice in their own hands. And the reconciliation started to happen. I would say it could have been done much better, in a better way, if the country wasn't so segregated and if the political establishment of this country was doing more pressure into this reconciliation. Not forget what happened, because we all lived in those days, and we cannot, we cannot of course forget what was going on at the time. But we have to, since we live together, we have to build some sort. We have to find some common grounds for a future for all of us.
I mean, we have Sarajevo in the background, and we are currently standing in Republic of Srpska.
Yes, so basically not currently, further, just below this road would be the, let's say, Republic of Srpska. Below us over here would be like Federation, so we are somehow in the border.
So I don't even know, even though we've just passed the border.
We are just in the border, you can't see the border, but somehow
this,
it's here.
For an outsider's point of view, this, it's a complicated,
very complicated
political situation in terms of how the land is divided up.
The idea of being in some other part than other part is taking some kind of ground over here, because I believe the some parts of this country, some people of this country believe that they conquered something. So what they conquered in war is theirs, and somehow they mark it with some symbols, some kind of flags and things like that. So unfortunately, I still think it matters a lot. The country is not unified in that sense. These invisible borders do exist a lot. They're not only invisible, I mean, they're invisible from perspective of seeing the borders or going across them, behind them, but they do exist in minds of people. They do exist a lot.
And do you think people who, Serbs who live in the Republic of Srpska in Bosnia, do you think they kind of harbour ideas about perhaps becoming an independent state or becoming
course,
a part of Serbia?
Of course. I mean, you can every day see these kind of tendencies in a way that... I would say, I mean, leadership of Republic of Srpska, the political leadership, they mention all the time referendums. I think the general idea still exists that maybe one day this Republic of Srpska thing will be independent. That exists, but it's been story so many years in the past.
Yeah.
So it somehow it faded, the kind of seriousness of this thing faded out. I'm sure that people on the other side would hardly agree to that. Mm. So from that perspective, I can't say what will happen in future because. I mean, there is, I think here, still, even the war ended, there is a peace, there is one line, and after you go behind that line, I don't know what will happen. Who knows? You cannot guarantee there will ever be a war in Bosnia again.
Yeah.
People are strange here.
I mean, this kind of tourism is war tourism. What do you think about people coming to the country for this kind of dark tourism?
Any tour we do, I don't know. Adventure to hiking, rafting, mountain biking, or cultural tours is always in the some part of it is related to the war.
Yeah.
People want to know because they remember it. Mm-hmm. They now know what they want to know what happened. They ask me about my personal experiences. It helps to break a prejudice because they come for war, no problem. But they get to know the other side as well.
Yeah.
So when they go back home, they can tell the other side too.
I've been to Bosnia a number of times over different years. I've seen this city change beyond recognition. When I first landed in Sarajevo 12 years ago. Buildings were shelled all around and it kind of felt the war was just finished. There's unbelievable changes since. So for Europeans, they quite often see Bosnia through the lens of conflict until they come here.
Yes.
And when you come to Bosnia today, I think you get a different sense of Bosnian people, of multiculturalism, perhaps multinationalism living in Sarajevo. So it's only by coming here, I think, that you get a sense of how Bosnia is changing, how Sarajevo is developing.
Sure. I mean, that's beyond any doubt. They get to see the good food, the nice people, hospitality, history, green mountains, rivers, lakes. I mean,
it's got everything.
It's got everything, you know. Yeah. Especially in the recent years, Bosnia is getting more popular for the people from the Middle East, who can come here and regardless from which religion your background you come, you get to see something of your side. Let's say, I mean, you have mosques, you have churches, Catholic, Orthodox, you have Jewish synagogues. Everyone can find something to. Everyone can find some common grounds with this area over here. Thank you.
So, in the era of Yugoslavia, there was a number of significant football matches. So, there was the game in 1990 at the Maxime Stadium between Red Star and Dinamo Zagreb, and with Boban kicking the policeman. Often, people in Zagreb thought that the Serb police were overrepresented in what was Yugoslavia, and lots of those matches in the Yugoslav League, which was a domestic league, were effectively international games in the minds of the people. So did that happen here when Red Star and you know, Dinamo came here? Was it like an international match when they played FK Sarajevo in the Yugoslav League?
Well, back in the days of Yugoslavia, football was on a much higher level. Quality of football was much greater. The passion, I would say, there were much more fans watching this football. So back in that time, when the Red Star comes, Partizan, Dinamo, Hajduk, when they would come here, it was a very important match. I wouldn't say it was a match which would require so much police attention, because which the match you mentioned, Zagreb, Red Star over there in Dinamo, it was the trigger of breakup of Yugoslavia. So yeah, that pretty much match at the time was already reflecting what the political situation was in the country. But in years before, it was a holiday for people. When the big clubs come, like those big four, as we used to call them here, it would be a big thing. Zvezdinčar and Sarajevo are equally fought on the high level of the table very often. Even our clubs used to win Yugoslavian championship.
But the fan groups from those big four, as you say, those hooligans became involved in the conflict, didn't they?
But for sure, for sure.
But did that not happen with the fan groups in Bosnia?
I wouldn't say to a big extent.
And what about your home stadium then? Because the place it was in, tell us a little bit about what
happened. Okay, my home stadium is called Grbavica. It's a home stadium of FK Zvezdinčar. And by unfortunate accident, the front line during the war was actually where the stadium is. In fact, during the war, the stadium was the front line, meaning it was a minefield. The football pitch was the minefield. The stadium was burnt to the ground pretty much and almost disappeared itself. And several years later, the local authorities and Zvezdinčar management and fans, they helped to reconstruct the club, to clean the minefields and make the terrain accessible for players to play. And until today, that is like a temple of football over here, and we like the stadium a lot.
Tell us about what's written currently across the shade then.
Of course. So in the recent years, Zvezdinčar has acquired new management in the club. So the idea is that the fans help the reconstruction of one of the stands of the stadium. So a few weeks earlier, there was this action of to acquire to like gather the money, and the idea is that fans pay the money as much as anybody can, and as a gratitude in exchange, the club came to idea to wear the ad, which actually is ad for the fans, which says mi smo željni, želja je naš. It means Željo belongs to us, we belong to Željo. So maybe this is the first club in the world whose main sponsor are the fans, not some brands or some rich people. It's actually the fans.
Yeah.
That's why the football is there for the fans.
So tell us about the derby, the rivalry between the two clubs in Sarajevo.
Okay, so in Bosnia you have the biggest rivalry, and in the city as well, is the rivalry between FK Zvezdinčar and FK Sarajevo. These are two clubs which are very old. One older is Zvezdinčar, which was made in 1921. The club is founded by the rail workers, the people from the low class.
So it's a working-class club.
Yeah, it's working-class, correct. That's correct word, and working-class club. But Sarajevo was founded in the name we know it today in 1945, so that is a club which was founded by the city authorities after the creation of Yugoslavia. So it is the idea that some higher class people needed to have a club for themselves. So
they
created
Torpedo.
Initially, that club at the time was called Torpedo, later renamed into FK Sarajevo. But we like to say, us Zvezdinčar fans, maniacs, we like to say the rivalry between Sarajevo and Zvezdinčar is like being fan of Sarajevo is a geographical thing, because you're born in Sarajevo, okay, that's your club. But being fan of Zvezdinčar is like a philosophical thing. You find idea of Zvezdinčar close to your heart. You don't have to be from Sarajevo to love this club. So that's the main idea. Philosophy versus geography.
So when the fans meet, the two teams meet as they're going to win the derby, what kind of things do we see? Is there pyrotechnics? Is there problems with the police? Do they fight each other?
Here, our thing is that we never fight. There is never police. In the years before, especially the older generation of people say that was never a problem, because here even family can be rivalry fans. You know, father and son, two brothers, so you don't expect them to fight. So here is more about teasing and making other jokes over the other side when he loses or wins.
So we've come here to one of the main fan clubs in Sarajevo before the derby, and we're going to meet some of the fans, see what it's like for them pre-match. So let's go in. So here we are in one of the maniac pubs for the game against FK Sarajevo today, and we've just got mass tickets. And they are 10 marks, which is £4 each. Happy days. So we're in the bar of the lads, the maniac lads, who are getting ready for today's derby.
As you can see here, there's a number of
preparations in place.
Just chopping up a flare with a knife here.
Yes.
You won't even ask him where he got the knife from. A few more to be chopped up.
This is the derby of Sarajevo and the biggest game in Bosnia.
Stadion gleda mi malo život ću dati, a u tebe ne da, jer ti si život moj.
How do you get away with taking all the pyro into the stadium? You hide it in your cell phone, aren't you? And did the police stop you? Is there a problem with the police in the end of London?
You have to pay around 250 euros. They find you and they can put you in court. That's on the police. Good or
I'm only expecting for today's game. Victory, of course, yeah. And how many fans will we take to escape the game?
Between 6,000 and 7,000
anyway. That's amazing. This is our
town. Support of a smaller club in Sarajevo. They call
the little club. Let's just see that badge. Club. Let's just see the badge.
It's aura, it's Lemo, a cigarette. Cigarettes are they sponsored.
So this is the derby?
Yeah.
Is it friendly?
Yes.
Yeah. Ah, look at that brotherly love, eh?
Okay, it's okay.
This guy goes everywhere with your club, yeah?
Yeah. And usually this guy is don't miss any game, you know. Whatever we play, you know, is coming with us stuck by the cars.
Yeah, he thumbs a lift, yeah, hitchhiking.
Yeah, he lives 250 kilometers from Sarajevo, but he is here every fucking game.
The different identities from Sarajevo.
Yeah, because we are not looking higher than Christians,
you just Sarajevo.
You have many clubs, you know, like Catholic clubs, Muslim clubs, right? Not like that.
Yeah.
No, you're just looking for the blue card. That's all.
Especially on Derby Day.
Yeah, especially on Derby
Day. We defend our town. We are here.
Usually in Sarajevo is a city like that.
Yeah.
Don't make the trouble here.
Yeah.
Don't look for the trouble. Stay and enjoy Sarajevo.
Yeah. So this is the walk to the match with the Maniacs group waiting for the derby.
2 days ago in Serbia, they made, you know, they arranged a fight and one guy is already dead and for the other guy...
Got stabbed in the heart, right?
They still know he's gonna survive or not. But
you were brought up in the war, basically, weren't you?
I was 9 years old.
Yeah.
I was born 1983 and I was 9 years old. I started, you know, I finished by the end of 1995. So I was almost old during the war, you know. And everything I saw and it happened. I sometimes try to forget, but even if you want, you cannot forget what's happened, you know.
So we've joined the rest of the group. We're going to walk up as away fans to the derby, walking to the Olympic Stadium. This is the derby, this is Sarajevo.
During the 15 minutes of break, we went to the center where the best man, bride, you know, and get married in the stadium. This one. Called him, not me. I didn't get married in the stadium. He did.
So we walked down with all the away fans and we're just about to go into the ground now. Unbelievable march, the best march I've ever done to a ground. And we're about to go in the away end. Derby to start. We're one of about 6,000 in the away end.
looks like it's going to be a different atmosphere. But most today was about the World Cup. That was the best march I've ever seen before any football game. 6,000 walking up as away fans, Claro singing, firecrackers, that absolutely
of what was Yugoslavia, football became a prelude to war. Rival hooligan firms, galvanised by televised football riots, formed the paramilitary groups who engaged in rape and genocide. But in Sarajevo, a city devastated by prolonged conflict, football has a distinctly different history and meaning. On the surface, Jelo v FK Sarajevo might seem like just another football derby, with that familiar blend of intensity and intimidation. But it lacks confrontation. The absence of violence and any real hostility between fans set this derby apart. The rivalry can divide brothers, but therein lies its unique essence. It transcends ethno-religious identities and divisions. If your city is besieged, and your home stadium becomes a frontline, the hallowed turf and minefield, a football club which survives and thrives with its unique, organic multiculturalism intact, inevitably comes to symbolise civic unity. The people's investment in the redevelopment of the stadium reinforces the place of the Jelo community in the city and in the imagination. And yet, in a land with deep divisions and visible scars, where mass graves of massacred people remain undiscovered, it will take more than football to heal wounds, reconcile the people, and build lasting unity in Bosnia and beyond.
Is there a time for keeping your distance? A time to turn your eyes away? Is there a time for keeping your head down? Forgetting on with the day? Is there a time?